If you're just joining us, welcome. I'm Maggie Daun. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. I'm joined this half hour by my friend, Milwaukee County Board Supervisor Deanna Alexander. Welcome, Deanna. Nice to have you.
Thank you for having me and honored to be acknowledged as your friend.
Oh my gosh. Heck yes. We've slogged through some moments at Milwaukee County. What got you into politics?
Well, I worked in public accounting when I first got out of college. I really enjoyed what I did. And that sort of had a non-reward system for the way my brain works. The money was good. It's good work. It's valuable work. But I found frustration that I was doing the same type of work over and over again. And you bring it to the client. You say, here's what we got to do next year for your audit or your taxes or whatever to make it good for you the way you want it to be. And they come back the following year and nothing has changed. And that environment of, you know, climb the firm, grow the money, climb the firm. It is for some people. It just wasn't for me. And I needed that intrinsic reward of being able to put effort into making the world a better place and fell into it after that.
And you took a brief break. You decided not to run, but you came back to the Milwaukee County Board, and congratulations on your recent reelection. What caused you to take a break and step back, and are you glad that you've come back to elected officialdom?
Boy, is that a double-sided sort of a question. First, I'll say that if you want to get into serving as an elected official, that takes campaigning. And to do either, you need to be in the mood to give blood, because if you don't give it, they will take it from you. When I first ran for public office back in 2012, starting a campaign in 2011, that was around the time that Milwaukee County voters were very focused on aftermath of the pension scandal. There was a lot of distrust for local public officials, even nonpartisan. It was also during the time of the Scott Walker recalls. So as I was knocking doors and trying to talk about the county budget, and I'm an accountant and a mom and a taxpayer, and I'd like to help out, it was very hyper-partisan and, you know, pick this side or that side, or who are you for? And even if I could get people to stop talking about the partisan angles of politics in Wisconsin, if I got the focus shift to Milwaukee County, they were very focused on, well, you just want it for the money, or you're just in it for you, because I hate politicians. And so through a series of conversations, I ended up taking a term limit oath, because I was so frustrated that I really wanted to be able to say, what would convince you that that's not who I am? Mm. And when people challenged me, I said, great, term limit oath done, 8 years, 2 terms, you know, I'll get in, do what I can, get out, and wash my hands of it and honor what I say I'll do. Now can we talk about the real business at hand? And I think, I don't know that people necessarily put value on trusting that, but it at least surprised them enough that I was willing to do it. So fast forward a little bit, I served a 4-year term, 2012 to 2016, reelected when they became 2-year terms and we went from full-time to part-time, reelected in 2016, and then served 2 years there, and then in 2018. In 2020, I did not run for reelection because I had that term limit oath in the back of my mind. And even though it wasn't very publicized, I really never wanted to put myself in a position to be a sitting duck and not a value to my district. So I didn't, you know, walk around advertising it for 8 years. But when the time came, I stood up, put my head down, and then stepped back and said, okay, anybody in my district who wants to run, I will sit down and have a coffee meeting with you. I will tell you what it takes to get involved. I will tell you, you know, the lay of the land of what it's like to perform this job for the county. And I invite people to step forward and I will open that door for you. One candidate ended up running unopposed, welcomed him into the role as I stepped out, said, if you need any help, assistance, guidance, whatever, reach out to me. But please do this job extraordinarily well, or I will come back with a vengeance once I have fulfilled my oath. 2 years later, after going into other work, I served as a village administrator, clerk, and treasurer in a small community north of Milwaukee. I realized that I was getting a lot of calls and emails and that from people in the community that were familiar with my time serving as an elected, and they said, will you please come back and run again? It turns out that the elected official that had filled the seat when I took the break did not get himself on the ballot. Everybody jumped into the race. I think we had maybe like a 7 or 8 way write-in campaign for the seat. And thank you for the voters for putting their trust to reelect me. I just finished that term, ran for my 5th term in office this April, and was very grateful and am humbled to have been the victor in that race. So we're back, but I remain very cognizant that I have to remain in the mood to give blood, because if I don't give it, they will take it.
Yes. Couple of things I wanted to lean into there. First of all, kudos to you for actually following your term limit pledge. Lots of very famous politicians in the state have given term limit pledges, and two of them have blown right past them. One is current sitting Senator Ron Johnson. He's like, what? What term limit pledge? Yeah. That one that you said before that you would only run twice. He's running again. And also Derek Van Orten made a term limit pledge and has blown right past that as well. So bravo to you for actually doing what you said you would do. And I wanted to ask you very briefly about, you used the phrase to give blood, and if you don't do it, they'll take it. What do you mean? Tell folks what you mean by that. I know what you mean, but I want to hear it in your words.
Can mean a lot of different things. I guess part of it is depending on what day you ask me. But, you know, I think that you have to be willing to make sacrifices. And the very definition of sacrifice is that it's not going to be comfortable. If it was, it wouldn't be a sacrifice. It would just be giving something, right? So, you know, that sacrifice might be, your time, your efforts, maybe working through a few pairs of shoes as you knock doors walking the miles. But once you really get into it, you can sacrifice your sanity. You can sacrifice your peace of mind. You can sacrifice your ability to go to a restaurant with your family and enjoy dinner without thinking about work because people recognize you. And then whether they're coming to applaud you or to yell at you, people know who you are. And you not only have to be on your best behavior, but you have to be ready to be on the clock and responsive at any time. When it comes to working with other elected officials, it's great when we can all take a portrait together. What's going on behind the scenes? What goes on in the hallways when we are not on camera? How do things get done? And I can tell, I guess, the listenership, because I know you know, Maggie, we never like to see how sausage is made.
Yeah.
And when you run for public office, I guess you're either going to give blood because you're going to run the race, you're going to do the work, and it's going to be painful and you will make sacrifices. Or you will not give the blood and everything will be taken from you because you're not pulling your weight. You're not doing your work or you're able to be pushed over. And, you know, I won't dive deep into it, but I will say that, you know, my marriage ended last year and I was married for 17 years and I never thought that I would be a person getting divorced. Mm. And when my ex and I went through evaluating, you know, what happened, I was shocked to hear him blame my position in the public eye and say, you were so viciously attacked by so many people for so long that it made me defensive. Mm. I don't know how much truth there is to it, but the fact that it made somebody who cares about me and who was part of my family say that means at least somebody had that perception.
Sure.
That the role of being in politics can affect you and affect your peace of mind and your home life at a very deep level.
Yeah.
So that's what I mean.
It's an interesting problem / question, right? Because on a certain level, I can imagine there are some folks in their cars listening to the radio going, well, you ask for it when you run. When you raise your hand and say, vote for me, I'll take on this to a certain degree, like kind of high profile public position. But I think what you refer to is, and I agree with that to an extent, but there is a level of personal attacks and the vitriol of things that I think is different now than I've ever seen. And I'm not just talking about Republican versus Democrat. Mm-hmm. I don't mean it in that way. Before you came on the air, I was reading some language that has been used that is so incendiary that just the rhetoric level is just ramped up to such a way that any line of attack against anybody seems to be considered fair game. Any amount of exaggeration and hyperbole to try to drive home a point is acceptable. And that's not even getting into sometimes our tenuous relationship with the truth, which is one of the things that I try to be very careful about, is getting the facts right and getting your name right, Deanna Alexander. But is that what you mean? That like the rhetoric, the amount of personal attacks, the score settling is just kind of at a new high, which is itself a low, if you will.
I do mean that, but I also mean that when you have the rhetoric going on and you are attacked, you have to figure out what to do.
Yeah.
And regardless of your decision, whether it's going to be to respond, to not respond, to attack back, to defend, you know, the very nature of our news cycle in this country and how everything is 24/7, everything is instant, everything is live. You know, there are some positive things, like even the show and our authentic conversation and the different mediums you can put it out in that can help us be close to people. But in today's society, if you're not fast to react, you're late to the game. Yeah. And so I can remember, you know, having notifications on my phone and my devices set up, and I would get 3 a.m., 4 a.m. Alerts of my name in the media, and I would be out of bed immediately crafting my press release response. And the stressors that it puts on you to be in constant fight or flight mode can be overwhelming. On another hand, you know, there was a situation where my father died in 2014. My family was really not prepared for it. And I was his only child with my mom. So I kind of took the lead in helping to figure out funeral, whatever. They needed help figuring out the financials.
Let me just put a quick pin in that. We're going to come right back. You sharing what I hope is maybe a positive upside of some things related to a personal experience that you had back in 2014. I am visited this half hour by my good friend and Milwaukee County Supervisor Deanna Alexander. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We'll be back with more in just a couple. Don't go anywhere. Again, with Supervisor Deanna Alexander here on The Maggie Daun Show. Welcome back, Wisconsin. Anya, always with the great appropriate music. I am sitting with a survivor, Deanna Alexander, a current Milwaukee County supervisor, was recounting a story of her early time in office back in 2014 when your father had just passed.
Right. So 2014, my father has died somewhat unexpected. My family wasn't prepared for it. And I remember being at the funeral home and we're trying to figure out how to pay these high bills. And the funeral director explains that it's, you know, a very popular becoming thing to do like a GoFundMe or something like that and tell people, you know, in lieu of flowers, please help us
defray the cost.
Right. You know. Pay the cost of the funeral and burial and whatnot. So my mom looks at me and she says, you know, I don't know how to set up any of that technology computer stuff. Will you help me? I said, of course I will. So I set up something that it was actually some website that was made for funeral type things. It wasn't directly a GoFundMe, but same concept where it was fundraising on the internet to pay your cost of whatever the emergency was. And I didn't advertise myself with, you know, my title or anything. I just, you know, said,
you.
He died. Here's my dad. Here's the family. Here's the obituary. You know, here's how to contribute. And interestingly, it became an attack on my family. The local newspaper got involved. I had reporters calling my half siblings out of state, trying to interview them. They did an investigation on whether or not my dad had life insurance or not, if my family had means or not to pay for it. They did several articles. They put a picture of me and my parents on the front page of the newspaper because someone complained that I was violating campaign finance laws by fundraising through my father's funeral, which was absolutely preposterous, completely unrelated. But then also, the day that we buried my father, I also had to go to work at the county board and take a vote. And the vote was on the question, should Milwaukee County stop paying for indigent burials for people who can't afford to pay for a burial? And on its face, a lot of people thought that was hypocritical, that I voted, yes, we should stop paying for this, when my own father was going through it. I was asking for, you know, ostensibly some form of public support. When I say public, I don't mean through the government, but through voluntary donations. And the interesting thing is, the reason that I voted, yes, we should stop paying for it, is because we had discovered that Social Security already had a program where they would pay for it. And these families were not eligible to get that Social Security funding because we offered a program to pay for it. So by ending our payment at the county level, then we could get the Social Security to pay for it. We could free up the money we had been using for other local causes and needs across the county. I thought that it was a very sound decision. People see this in the news at the same time. Deanna's dad passes away. She's asking for help. And also, Deanna votes against helping, you know, indigent burials. They put the two together without the context very easily, very quickly. And these news stories just fueled it. My family got death threats out of it. I had people tracking down my kids and saying, I know where your kids go to school. I'm going to kill them. You should throw yourself in your grave with your father. You're worthless. And they attacked me so viciously that I really had to start watching behind my back and get law enforcement involved. It was a very scary time. So I'm not saying that always serving in public service is like that. But the very fact that all I did was try to help my family and then show up to work and place a vote based on the facts I had got me into a lot of uncomfortable trouble very quickly. You know, on the other hand, I went out for a traditional Wisconsin fish fry the other night, walked into the restaurant. A voter saw me, recognized me. I don't recall meeting her, but in the past. But she said, you sent me a personal letter. Here's my name, the street I live in. I said, yes, now I remember. She said, thank you so much for putting your efforts in. I've supported you every election. I'm glad you won, and I support you ongoing. And so those little things from the voters that, you know, I kind of get the feeling that they understand sometimes that a lot of us are just a lot of do-gooders. We want to see the world be a better place. And that's the reason, Maggie, back to your question, the hypothetical of, you know, did you sign up for this? No, I didn't sign up to get harassed, but I did sign up to put my efforts in, my smart girl hat on and my big girl panties on, and make the world a better place. And if nobody does it, then I'm going to step up and do it. And I hope others join me making their contributions to the world.
Yes, I think people today are oftentimes sort of repulsed by the political process. And I understand that, right? People, it becomes easier and easier for folks to, there's plenty of reasons why not to engage or why to think this doesn't matter. I disagree with all of them, right? But I can understand why folks sometimes just don't want to become part of the process, that people don't even think about running for elected offices. One of the things that I often struggled with was talking to my friends who don't vote and trying to encourage them. It's your opportunity. And if there's one issue, forget all of the one thing that's really important to you, or that you think it is, it your parks that you go to? Are you someone that enjoys hunting and fishing? Whatever your thing is, you can find out probably quite a bit about a candidate or a whole bunch of candidates on the one or two things that you think are really important. And one of the things that I think your story illustrates, Deanna, is that when people lie, either by omission, lack of context, the framework, whether it's candidates themselves or media distortion, it does all of us a disservice, and it can, in fact, be incredibly dangerous. I wanted to give you a chance to address, you are a more conservative person. Generally, you think of yourself as a Republican. How is it being a Republican in this moment where there seems to be a lot of litmus testing of conservatives within the GOP? Like, you got to be on the party line. Here are the things that you have to support.
Oh, so many different trains of thought come to my ADHD brain at the moment, and I'm going to try to only let one or two through. you know, when I was out on the campaign trail this season, it's interesting because I ran into a guy out taking his morning jog. I said, "Hey, sir, I'm out campaigning. Can I give you my flyer?" And he kind of glares at me. He goes, "Democrat or Republican?" And I looked at him because, you know, I used to be part of the Republican Party. I don't necessarily disavow the Republican ideals or party per se, but I'm not part of the party anymore. And I try to stay out of direct party politics. I consider myself an independent now. And so I kind of chuckled. I said, "That's your question for me. On Milwaukee County issues in a nonpartisan race, you want to know which party I'm part of." And I must have been in a right mood. And he said, "Okay, Mrs. Alexander, I'm going to go ahead and give you a different question. Here's your litmus test. Do you want to see marijuana legalized in Milwaukee County?" And I said, "Well, I have no control or power over that. That would be a state or federal level concern. However, I would support the decriminalization of marijuana and possibly the legalization on in Wisconsin and Milwaukee County." And he was so turned off by that. He said, "Well, you lost my vote forever, and I'm going to vote for your opponent." And I just thought, wow, that was your litmus test. And yet you don't realize that my opponent is probably far more, you know, liberal or pro than I am. You know, I'm very moderate to pro on that issue. But, you know, on other issues, I identify very conservatively. So I consider myself independent. And it's funny how people do their litmus tests.
Yeah. Well, we are out of time. Will you come back again, Deanna? This was great fun. I really appreciate your time.
I would love to come back. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. I was joined this half hour by Milwaukee County Supervisor Deanna Alexander. Keep it locked, everybody. Bottom of the hour farm and news updates coming at you. We're going to finish it out. I got to tell you a little bit about some RFK randomness that went on this past week. I'm Maggie Daun. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Keep it locked. More in a moment. Own diamonds and I buy my own rings. Only ring your celly when I'm feeling lonely. When it's all over, please get up and leave. Question, tell me how you feel about this. Try to control me, boy, you get dismissed. Pay my own condo and I pay my own bills. Always 50-50 in relationships. The shoes on my feet, I bought. The clothes I'm wearing, I bought. The rock I'm rocking, I bought. Cause I depend on me. If I want it, the watch I'm wearing. Welcome back, Wisconsin. I'm Maggie Daun. You are listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. What you're about to hear is me cracking open my afternoon diet soda beverage.
Not sponsored.
Can
we get that sponsor money? We'll throw names around.
That's right. But I got to tell you, diet soda, it's like the fifth food group for me on you.
Oh, for sure.
Can't make it through an afternoon without it. But I also couldn't let this news story go unobserved on the Maggie Daun Show. Couldn't get through my show today without it. Tried to get through yesterday. Ran out of time because we were having such a great conversation with everybody. So Robert F. Kennedy Jr. is like an anti-vax conspiracy theorist who's trading on his family's name. I'm sure making his dad and his uncle roll over in their graves, who poses a serious threat to President Biden's reelection, just like Jill Stein did back in 2016 in the Clinton-Trump election. I was apoplectic then about people who were far-left progressives saying, "I'm going to sit this one out, same problem then, or I'm going to vote for Jill Stein as a lodge a protest vote. Because I don't want to vote for Hillary Clinton." It's nonsense. It's really irresponsible. And RFK Jr., really irresponsible nonsense. And he picked some donor class, anti-vax lie spreader as his running mate.
I think she's the wife or ex-wife of the founder of Google as well. There's a lot of money behind that. It's a very interesting person, yes.
Lovely.
She's got a lot. When I looked her up, there were a lot of articles like, "Is she still seeing Elon Musk?" And I'm like, was she seeing Elon Musk? So it's a lot of interesting ties out there in the world.
Yeah, that conjures up some really scary.
You want that guy kicking his feet up in the Oval Office with his friend, the First Lady of, yeah, or the Vice President, I should say. Sorry, yeah.
Elon Musk does not need any more access to levers of power and influence.
No new friends for Elon Musk. Yeah, no new friends.
So I wanted to share with you what happened because I have a hard time even following it. Okay. So apparently early last week, RFK, his campaign, he's running as an independent, sent out a fundraising email describing January 6th rioters as activists. Like an attempted coup, an insurrection, trying to stop the counting of the electoral votes. Again, trying to interrupt the peaceful transition of power doesn't make you an activist. It makes you a criminal and a treasonist. So he sends out this fundraising email. Quote, January 6th is one of the most polarizing topics on the political landscape. I am listening to people of diverse viewpoints on it in order to make sense of the event and what followed. I want to hear every side, the email began. Say what? There's no diverse viewpoints. They chanted, hang Mike Pence. People were fleeing for their lives, including Josh Hawley, who had thrown up the fist at the rioters on his way in and then ran like a scared little kid. The email went on. He acknowledged it, or says he is, quote, concerned about the possibility that political objectives motivated the vigor of the prosecution of the J6 defendants, their long sentences, and their harsh treatments, end quote. What the hell is wrong with this guy? He went on to say, if elected, he would appoint a special counsel to investigate possible prosecutorial misconduct. What? Again, this is this conceit, this ruse where it's like, oh, I'm going to get a prosecutor to investigate the prosecutors. Feeding into this baloney narrative that these are like political prisoners. No, you're criminals. You're trespassing criminals lied to and manipulated that had your fears, your deepest fears about our country exploited by Donald Trump and every single one of his co-conspirators. Absolutely horrifying. And every court that looked at this, many, tens of cases, I don't know, 70 plus cases, not a single court, not a single judge ever found any direct evidence of any election improprieties that would have changed the outcome. Facts. Anybody else that tells you differently has no evidence thereof and is lying to you, either by exaggeration or omission. So what the hell is RFK talking about? Why is this acceptable? If you're an independent, why would the... Talking about dangerous candidates, this guy. Now, here, so he puts the email out. Then he basically tried to retract the email that called them activists. Literally put out a statement retracting the fundraising email, saying the language had been included by a, quote, new marketing contractor that did not reflect Kennedy's views. I mean, there's some accountability. I'll blame the guy that works for me. Try these words out, RFK. I'm sorry. But then on Friday, so, okay, you got to get this straight because it's so bananas. Puts out the fundraising email calling the J6 rioters and criminals activists. Then retracts it, blames a, quote, new marketing contractor and saying that doesn't reflect his views. But then on Friday, put out another, like, retraction of the retraction, more or less, Anya. I cannot make this stuff up. Saying that The allegedly aggressive prosecutions fit a disturbing pattern of the weaponization of government agencies, naming the DOJ, the IRS, the SEC, the FBI, etc., against political opponents, end quote. What?
That's some word soup, but getting closer to word vomit. That is just so much that isn't meaningful. Yeah.
Flippity floppity flip 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 flip. He wants to have his cake and eat it too. This is my problem. I have a real problem with independents or Republicans that won't call out January 6th for what it was. It was a violent mob. People were armed. They threatened the life of the vice president, and they did so based on lies told by Donald Trump and a whole slew of lawyers that are losing their law licenses because there was no evidence to support the allegation that there was any sort of election impropriety at a level that would impact the outcome. They denied that Joe Biden was the winner of the 2020 election. To any conservative or Republican, question, are those political prisoners, the January 6th rioters, or are they insurrectionists? Did they commit crimes? Is Joe Biden the legitimate president of the country? Baseline questions. Is what happened on January 6th an acceptable demonstration of disapproval with an election outcome? Hell no, it's not. Wait, listen, we can have protests. These are complicated times. People have a right to express themselves. You don't have a right to storm the Capitol and stop the vote. Take a crap in the rotunda. Put your feet up on Nancy Pelosi's desk. Rifle through her mail. Threaten to kill the vice president. Erecting a hangman scaffold. You could erect the hangman scaffold. That would be protected First Amendment speech. But when you, again, breach the barriers and trespass and destroy property, those are crimes. Cam texting in, my tinfoil hat has been feeling like a lot of these people standing up at Democratic conventions to yell about the Palestinian question. Maybe these folks are paid by right-wing groups. Don't get me wrong. Tons of people feel strongly about it, and I get why, but I feel like most people would normally understand that Trump is not an alternative if you support the project of peace. Spent the first hour, if you want to listen back to the conversation, if you've just joined us, talking about this ridiculous idea coming from some progressives on the far left that, oh, just don't vote in November. That'll help the situation in Gaza. Vote your conscience by not voting. It's stupid. And to answer Cam, no, these aren't right-wing plants, but they sure as heck feel like it. Ryan Clancy, Representative Clancy in the Wisconsin Assembly, is a socialist Democrat. And he's the one out saying some of this just crazy nonsense. Talk about being out of touch with the Democratic Party. No, that's you, Representative Clancy. You are totally out of touch. Get back in your Tesla, cash your trust fund checks, or enjoy the privileged upbringing that you clearly had. While the rest of us schmucks that are just regular people working hard every day have to live here on planet Earth, you know, in reality. What the hell is wrong with RFK and his campaign? It's like you retract the retraction and what it's about are the January 6th insurrectionists. Like, what? Talking out of both sides of his mouth, literally. This is, okay, from the retraction of the retraction. This is more RFK last week. Because it happened with the encouragement of President Trump and in the context of his delusion that the election was stolen from him, many people see it not as a riot, but an insurrection, Kennedy wrote. So again, like, having it both ways much, Robert?
That's like the exact opposite. Yeah, that's the...
Yes!
Did I hear that right? Wow.
Yes!
Even the producer is shocked. Wow.
Hard to do, grizzled radio veteran that Anya is.
Clearly.
He goes on, quote, I have not examined the evidence in detail. Just run the footage. But reasonable people, including Trump appointments, opponents, excuse me, tell me there is little evidence of a true insurrection. They observe that protesters carried no weapons, had no plans or ability to seize the reins of government, and that Trump himself had urged them to protest peacefully. What are you talking about? Yes, they had weapons. A freaking pipe bomb was found in D.C. Enrique Tarrio was organizing an armed insurrection. That's what was going on, Robert F. Kennedy. And by the way, how is this possible? And it was a false flag operation. I'm not sure. I can't, those two, but they seem to trot either one of those arguments out whenever convenient.
It's one of those false positive flags.
Yeah.
You know, the ones you hear about all the time?
Yeah.
A little both.
We've never heard of those things, right? Like, that's bananas. This is unacceptable. Unacceptable. Where do you stand, RFK? Because I don't think you actually know. All you want to do is grab headlines, grandstand, pat yourself on the back, trot out your bizarro conspiracy, anti-vax theories, and cash your checks. This is the guy that's getting paid nearly $500,000 a year by one of the wackadoo anti-vax groups that popped up as a million Americans were dying during COVID. That's this guy. Stop cashing checks based on lies, RFK. Shameful. When we come back, I will talk briefly about one of those very co-conspirators, one of the disbarred lawyers, because the 128-page decision by the California Bar to disbar John Eastman is worth us paying a little attention. So keep it locked, everybody. I'm Maggie Daun. You're listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Join me for the last segment, 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842. Keep it locked. Welcome back, Wisconsin. You are listening to The Maggie Daun Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. You want to get in on the action for the last segment of the day, 855-75-CIVIC. That's 855-752-4842. Another funny text from Cam and Nina talking about RFK can't figure out what he thinks about January 6th and sent a fundraising email that called the January 6th insurrectionists activists, then retract that, but then retract the retraction and engaged in a bunch of doublespeak, all in the course of like 3 or 4 days last week.
Retractivists. That's what they could be. Retractivists. There we go.
He's a retractivist. He's something. A conspiracy theorist, an anti-vaxxer, and a retractivist of the highest order. Here's Cam from Nita. You want to be the blankety blank president, but don't have an opinion on J6th, RFK? I don't want you holding the nuclear football, let alone a piece of string. Here, Cam. I told you yesterday it was one of my bits of good news that John Eastman has been disbarred in Florida. Now he's not Florida, California. Now he's going to appeal that. It's not the last word on the matter. But the judge that oversaw his disbarment trial, California basically has a full-blown trial when people get disbarred and want to challenge these disciplinary proceedings. The trial lasted 35 days, 24 witnesses, and over 700 pieces of evidence were entered. And the judge wrote a 128-page opinion. And guess who read it for all of you? Me!
Good job, Maggie.
Yeah, a little light reading.
Maggie, for non-lawyers, is this a big... what did you call this? This is his dissent. Is this a big one?
Disbarment.
Or disbarment. Is this a lot of paperwork for this?
This was a huge big deal. There were evidentiary motions. And disbarment, in case I need to be more specific.
Yeah, what is that?
Eastman is a lawyer. He's basically the architect of the plan that, we'll put in the fake electors, which Ron Johnson happily passed along, Wisconsin's fake slate of electors that were never certified by state governments or signed by the governors of the, quote, contested states, read Pennsylvania, Michigan, Wisconsin, Ohio, Arizona, and Georgia. John Eastman is a lawyer, and so to be disbarred means your law license is revoked and you can no longer be a lawyer, right? Which, incidentally, might put a little cramp in his pocketbook as he's trying to defend himself in the Georgia criminal prosecution. But the guy was called throughout the 128 pages. I may take some time tomorrow and go through this in detail with y'all because I don't want to rush through it today. So if you want to hear me talk about Eastman, I'm going to go through the 128-page decision. We'll do that tomorrow on the Maggie Daun Show. But I thought we could whet everybody's palate, if you will, a little amuse-bouche for tomorrow's Maggie Daun Show by listening to a little bit of what John Eastman said in a recent interview. Now, he was interviewed by this guy, Tom Klingenstein. You can find it. He's the chairman of the board of the Claremont Institute. It's a very, very conservative quasi-think tank. And so he sits down for this interview. Mind you, this is before he gets disbarred, but he knows that he's facing these disciplinary proceedings. So he sits down and basically doubles down in this interview on all of the garbage. I actually want us to start with, let's do the first John Eastman cut, and then I've got two of them. And I picked these out. They're right from the beginning of his interview. It's like a three-hour interview nearly. You can go check it out. Just Google John Eastman interview Claremont, C-L-A-R-E-M-O-N-T. Let's just listen to this first cut.
Now, you assisted Trump, who was your client, in trying to persuade Vice President Pence to postpone the counting for 7 to 10 days. To be clear, you weren't asking Pence to reject any electoral votes, as I believe Pence has stated. Rather, you were asking Pence to postpone the counting for 7 to 10 days, which might have given several key states time to determine who had actually won the election. But even delaying the vote was, as you readily acknowledge, a very aggressive position to take. But you thought it was defensible or plausible, and in the circumstances worth pursuing. Circumstances we shall discuss. So, the central wrong, as you see it, is that the election was stolen. You thought Trump had actually won the election, right?
Normal things are fraud, but more importantly, and the things I focused on, were the alterations of state election law by non-legislative actors, secretaries of state, county clerks, even in some cases, state judges. And they have no authority to do that under the federal constitution, which assigns the exclusive power to the state legislature to direct the manner of choosing presidential electors.
There's so much here. I could lose my mind for hours on this. So this guy sets up this question by saying, you weren't asking President Pence to reject electoral votes. Yes, he was. In order to delay the vote, the vice president or the secretary of the Senate, as he's acting in that capacity on January 6th, would have to find some reason to not count the appropriately certified electoral votes. That, in lay people speak, is rejecting them. Otherwise, there's no frickin' basis to delay the counting. And by the way, and I'll talk more about this tomorrow, in other writings going back a number of years, Eastman has made patently clear that the vice president has no independent authority to act outside of Congress. In other words, he's just there as a functionary to count the darn votes. That's it. No more, no less. So all of a sudden, when it came to January 6th, now John Eastman thinks that the president can basically exercise his own personal judgment about whether or not to count the electoral votes? Liar. We're not even going to get to the second cut today. You're going to want to come back tomorrow because I'm going to do a deep dive on John Eastman. I got all the times. The court basically said, you're a big fat liar. You knew there was no evidence of any of this. And you made the arguments anyways, which is a betrayal of your oath as a lawyer, as a citizen, and violates the most fundamental of our American values. I'm Maggie Daun. That's it for this Tuesday's edition of The Maggie Daun Show. Come back with me tomorrow. Anya will be here. Listen to some more John Eastman. It's been a pleasure, y'all. I'll stand up for you. I hope you stand up for me. But remember, it's always better when we stand together.